Church, well, you look great this morning. How are you feeling? Awesome. You look better than that. So we are in our last installment of the I Am series. Have you enjoyed the I Am series so far, for any of you who have been in it? Yeah, I'm really impressed by this series, actually, because I think that this is one of those series that you should probably get from the bookstore and listen to over and over and over again. Because if you get the real identity that God knows about you, if you get that, your whole life will never be the same. Amen? So, and I really appreciate, Tracy gave me the mic today, so she is completely out of control of this service at this point. So I really appreciate what Pastor Tracy does behind the scenes for you guys. Because what I know is I've been in church for a very, very long time. And I've been in ministry for maybe 13, 15 years, something like that. And I have never seen somebody, and I live with this woman, who takes it so seriously, your spiritual growth. So I think, just for one second, that we should honor her this morning for what she does for you. Okay, now you can sit down because now I am in total trouble. But there's still stories that I will tell today that will get me into more trouble, I'm sure. So would you do this? Let's do this declaration so that we can get back on point. Because the only thing that she's in control of is she gave me like 29 minutes to do this whole thing. All right, so would you say this after me? Because what we want to do is we want to get our hearts prepared to receive the word today, all right? So today, I will hear the voice of God. Through the word of God. My eyes will be enlightened, and I will be changed. Now turn to somebody and tell them that you will be changed. Now turn to your second choice and let them know that you're going to be changed today. So because Pastor Tracy did such a great job with this series and with the slides, I felt like I would steal her slides and use those today just off the start, just in case you haven't been around for this series, okay? Because I feel like it's really, really important that we take this whole series into today's message, okay? So what I want to show you is a couple of the slides that she used. And you remember this slide for those of you that were in this series so far. This is really the process that we've been talking about finding our identity in Christ or knowing who we are in Christ, right? So it starts here with the spirit and soul empty. It comes here with the new birth where Jesus enters your spirit and now your soul has some work to do, right? So you start dragging the great things that Jesus offered you into your soul and you end up transformed, right? So then we get to our next slide, and our next slide shows us what the spirit has to offer and what our soul has to offer, right? So we are in a constant state of trying to get more of this spirit over to our soul. And eventually, hopefully, in our process of transformation, we get to our third slide and our soul starts to match up with what the Spirit of God says. So now, when you get in situations or circumstances that look ugly, you don't rely on the circumstance to tell you who you are. You rely on what God has done in your spirit, trained your soul to tell you who you are in your situations, right? So today, and I think that this picture right here, I think that this shows us the definition of prosperity. This is true prosperity. We may define it other ways, but I think this is true prosperity. So today, I'd like to speak to you on the topic of I am prosperous. Because I feel like we've defined it wrong for maybe too long, and we're looking for something that isn't really what we should be looking for first. Because we have a shift of what God has put in our heart, in our spirit man. We have a shift of that into our soul, and once we get there, we are prosperous individuals. And that's what I'm going to try and prove today. So let me start here. I don't know if you have seen the video that our amazing creative department put together with a student who serves in children's ministry. It was a Grow Team video. The student's name was Ruben. And he said something in that video that caught me. okay? Because of the way that I define prosperity. And he said this. He said, I like to see kids grow and prosper as the weeks go by. And I thought, interesting, that word prosper there doesn't seem to be the way that I define it, because he's talking about children. So if you're talking about children and prosper, you wouldn't be talking about a big bank account, right? You wouldn't be talking about the things that we would usually define as prosperity. You would be looking at something else, and I wonder what he sees that he would define as prosperity, because maybe that can help us see prosperity a little bit different. So what might he see in the children's department as they sow into these children every single week at Grow Church? He might see that their soul starts to be transformed by their spirit and their actions change. So maybe there's something different about the prosperous life that God's trying to get us to than just a bank account. Maybe there's a full heart of prosperity that's full of good that we can offer to other people. Maybe that's where it starts. I remember when Pablo and Connie came to the church to start. This was like six, seven years ago. And there are Hispanic ministry directors. They are amazing individuals, I gotta tell you. Now, when they came to the church, I remember about 6 months to a year later, we started seeing some of their friends show up at the church. And we started asking them questions like, well, what were they like beforehand? Because these people would come to the church and they would say like, well, if you knew Pablo before he got to church, you'd be coming to try and find out what he's on too. Because he was a totally different individual. And I wonder if prosperity is something that our heart takes shape of and then people can see on the outside. So instead of us trying to get to prosperity as something that we can see, maybe the transformation's supposed to start inside and that's what other people see. Just a suggestion. So maybe we need to redefine prosperity so that we can actually get somewhere and see where God's trying to take us. So in your worship guide, you'll find the worship guide is what we call that brochure thing that you grab on your way into the auditorium. In there, we have some notes so you can fill in the blanks or doodle or whatever it is that you would like to do with them. First point in your notes for today is prosperity is a position of the soul prior to significance. Prosperity is a position of the soul prior to significance. So if you want to be prosperous, then you need to work on your soul first. Amen? I got one guy tuned in over here. It's totally cool. Thank you. Thank you for being here this morning. I need you. So here's what I'm suggesting, that in the process of shifting our spirit man over into our soul in our heart, we are actually half-hearted until we make the shift. Have you ever done anything half-hearted in your life? You have any kids that do things half-hearted? Yeah, like vacuuming or the dishes? What's a half-hearted dishwashing job look like? You're laughing because you know, right? So what if we did everything half-hearted in our life? And most of us, in a lot of ways, we kind of are, because there's things that God's trying to change in us or help us with that we continue to avoid and look elsewhere for this thing that we call prosperity, right? So prosperity is a heart position before success comes. True success is a result of a heart full of good. A heart full of good, not just one half, but a heart full of good, right? So the prosperity process, let's go back to the first slide, just real quick. So the prosperity process is this. The Spirit enters through salvation. So you ask Jesus into your heart. He enters. He has everything that you need to spread into your soul. So he enters, he spreads into your soul, takes over the heart, and then it becomes visible. Is that clear? Now you can really walk in the prosperity that God would have you walk in. So this was new. This definition was kind of new to me as I was looking at this. So that's why I was kind of taking it slow off the start, because I want to get us somewhere today where our heart is full of good so that we can get everywhere that God's called us to get. So our problem seems to be that we want the visible prosperity before we change inside. So I've got good and I've got bad news for you. Which one do you want first? All right, cool. I'll give you the good news. Whatever you said there, I was going to give you the good news first anyway. So the good news is, and in your worship guide, God wants to prosper you. That was a way better spot for an amen right there. Should I do that whole stanza again or no? God wants to prosper you. He does. There you go. Now you're following. So here's the bad news. You wanted that too, right? The bad news is, and in your worship guide, he might want to do it in an uncomfortable way. I know, I had to do that to you. So let's go to Romans 8:28, because you've defined it one way, and I want to redefine it for you today, because I love this scripture. And it says, "And we know that God causes everything to work together for good for those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them," right? So we go, well, when I'm a Christian, then everything's just supposed to be great all the time. Anyone find out that that is not true? What's true is this. It doesn't mean that everything is good all the time. What it means is it's good when God's done. Right? So sometimes we need to lose a couple of battles so that we will change so that he can win the war with us. Right? Now, that's hard to understand because the battle is all we see when we're in it. But God's looking for a greater purpose. He's trying to take you to something greater than just the little circumstance that's in front of you. What he needs to do is change you, help you change, so that when you get to the bigger scenario, the bigger situation, the one that was actually going to take you out, he turns the tide and you win. Okay? So that's what he's trying to do throughout your circumstances that are happening to you. He's trying to get you to a place where you can withstand more. So guys, specifically for you, just because I am a guy, so I've been a guy for a long time, as long as I can remember, so I can speak specifically to you guys. Here's the thing. You have the Holy Spirit inside of your heart. So you don't have to wait for your spouse to tell you to activate him. Okay? Women, this is for you too. But I don't know you as well as I know them. So what you have is the Holy Spirit inside of you who wants to lead you, who wants to help your soul prosper, yes. Right? That's the scripture. So what you can do is listen to him and not wait for your spouse to kind of give you a bump to grow, right? Singles, how many singles do we have in the room? All right. Single ladies, raise your hands. All right, single ladies, hold them up nice and high. Okay, you can put those down. Single guys, I didn't tell you to raise your hands. You're welcome. Just helping a brother out up in this place. I don't know. No, really. What I meant was you don't have to wait for your future spouse to arrive to change. Because actually, that's what they're waiting for. I pictured that going over better than that. I'm not sure. So God uses multiple things to make you prosperous, to push you forward, to help you grow, to speed up your prosperity, right? He uses the word. He uses other people. He uses the Spirit within you. So if you don't have a Bible time or a friend that can keep you accountable or a relationship with God, you don't have all the key ingredients that he wants to surround you with to grow. Okay, so you can just take one or the other. You can get started somewhere, right? And if you remember in the slide, if you can go back to that slide for me for a second, a lot of these things are actually related to the fruits of the Spirit. So God can actually use the fruits of the Spirit to help you grow. I've got a story that goes along with this. You want to hear it? So I am blessed with a particular set of skills. Okay, kind of like Liam Neeson, but not at all as cool. So when I travel, which I do quite frequently, okay, I can go on a layover in Atlanta, which is a lot of times where I lay over, right? So ATL, I land in ATL, and I can get through that airport so fast that a blink of an eye, I'm through that airport. I can land at one side and get to the other in less than 10 minutes. And by the way, I just did this like a week and a half ago. Okay, so I landed and I even tricked Delta because they thought that I missed my flight. Poof, that specific set of skills that God has blessed me with. Boom, I appear on the flight and they go, what? We've already rebooked you. And I go, yeah, it's because I'm like Liam Neeson, just not as cool. So that did happen, but the Liam Neeson part didn't. So then a couple months ago, I'm traveling with my wife. And we lay over in ATL, okay? So we get there and I figure out that I forgot to mention my specific set of skills to her, right? So she gets there and she has like high heels on, which are not right for this job at ATL. So she knows that we are very tight on our layover, but she cannot keep up the pace, right? So I feel like, okay, I can handle this. And I kept at peace and I was whatever. And so we get to vacation and we come back, we lay over in ATL again. So before we got there, I talked to her about her shoe selection, okay? So she put on sneaks. So she's wearing sneakers, and I might have even said, like, do you ever double knot those sneakers? May have said that. I can't remember if I said that once or 1,000 times. So we get to ATL this time, and we're really tight on our layover, right? And what's happening is she's falling behind because three times, not one or two, but three times those shoes came undone. We pulled it over to the side. We took care of those shoes, but we did not double knot them, not even once. What I recognized is when I was rolling my eyes, I know it's not like a pastor to do that, but it's like after three times, would all of you roll your eyes at this point? Yeah. Okay. Thank you. See? Okay. So remember how I said I was getting in trouble today? This is happening. So what I recognized is, though, I wasn't necessarily rolling my eyes at my wife. What I was doing is rolling my eyes at something that God was trying to train me in, which is called patience. Ooh. So all of you shut up. Okay, I got to continue. I only got like 13 minutes left. So it's not just all about, me ripping on Tracy today, because she has a particular set of skills for Costco. And she has decided that I don't. And because, like, I go into Costco and there's samples on every aisle, and their Costco pizza is amazing. So I get sidetracked, or if I'm hungry, I buy extra stuff. So she started using her specific set of skills and just using the app called Shipt so that I don't fill up the house with unhealthy things. So I don't know. What the point is here is God is trying to prosper us at all times. But I wonder if we recognize it, or I wonder if we roll our eyes at him who's trying to make us prosperous in every way. So in every challenge that's in front of us, we look at it and we go, and we don't use what he's trying to do to benefit us. What he's trying to do is, even those nasty fruits of the spirit that he's trying to work in you, he wants to take you somewhere. He wants to elevate you. He wants to get you to a place of prosperity. But what he has to do is get your spirit man shifted over into your soul. So in every situation, you act the part. You act what he's called you to be. I see that the number one reason that we don't like this as humans is because we do not want to change. What I'm suggesting is that maybe we should get a like to change somehow and start working on it, because he's trying to take you someplace that you've always wanted to be, but you've held up the process. So it takes me to the Apostle Paul before he's the Apostle Paul. His name's Saul. He's on the road to Damascus, okay? We pick this up in Acts 26:14 when God shows up on the scene. And he says this, and when we all had fallen to the ground, I heard a voice speaking to me and saying in the Hebrew language, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads. Here's the thing that he's trying to get across to Paul. So I had to research this a little bit because it's not our normal terminology, right? Like kick against the goads. What is this thing that God's trying to show us here? And it's this, that the goads on an oxen, if an oxen is getting off its path, the farmer can kick the goads, which kind of stabs into the oxen, and the oxen goes, whoa, I must be off track, and he gets back in line. But what he's saying to Saul here is that Saul is kicking against his own goads, the goads that maybe God is trying to help him direct his path with. And it almost seems like God's been trying to work with Saul for quite a while before this scripture even happens. And then he shows up to Saul on the road to Damascus. And he says, Saul, why are you persecuting? Why are you kicking against the goads? And I wonder, like an oxen, if they kick against their own goads because it hurts, right? So they want to get rid of it. They kick against it and it actually hurts them worse. I wonder what he's trying to tell us here. Maybe God has been trying to change us for so long, and we need to recognize that it's him trying to get us to prosperity, trying to get us to a prosperous life that we've been asking him for, but there's some change that has to happen first. Like he's trying to take us somewhere because he loves us and we continue to fight against him. So maybe it's more like we should welcome some of the struggle instead of fight against it so much, because he's actually, in your worship guide notes, speeding up my process. He's speeding up my prosperity by way of sometimes the struggle. Now, I don't want to get crazy with the struggle, okay? What I want to be clear on is I'm not talking about sickness and disease as a struggle. So don't get that mixed up. I'm talking about those things that need to land in our soul, that he needs to transform our entire heart so that we're not half-hearted. I'm talking about those things that he's trying to change you in. He's put people around you to recognize them, and you've shut those people out because you know that they're right, you're just not ready to change yet. What I'm suggesting today is let's ready ourselves for some change, because then we can speed up the process that God's trying to take us to get to the blessing. Now that we've said the blessing, Galatians 3:14 says this, that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles. So I guess the blessing of Abraham, way back in the old covenant, was intended for you, who he defines as the Gentile, right? Which it was designed for you all along. Because he knew that Jesus was coming and would open the door for the blessing of Abraham to be on you. And I was going to read all the way through this, but I can see that I am totally running out of time. So Deuteronomy 28:2-13, what I want you to do is go back to this during the week, because this is the blessing. This is the blessing of Abraham. I'm just gonna highlight a piece of it, but you need to go back to this because you need to see what the blessing is for you, okay? And read it in multiple different translations of the word, because when we know the blessing, when we know what God is trying to take us to, we'll be more apt to say, oh, God, what are you trying to train me in this time? How are you speeding up my prosperity with this change or with this redirection, right? So I want you to go back and read that, because that's the blessing for you. Now, when we get to verse 12, I'll kind of pick up at verse 12. It says, the Lord will open the heavens, the storehouse of his bounty, to send rain on your land in season and to bless all the work of your hands. You will lend to many nations, but will borrow from none. The Lord will make you the head, not the tail. Amen? If you pay attention to the commands of the Lord your God that I give you this day and carefully follow them, you will always be at the top and never at the bottom. Oh, that's good. Right. So verse 12 takes us to another spot that we likely are kicking against the goads. Because what I would say is verse 12 kind of takes us into Malachi 3:10 because it uses some of the same terminology. And it's either finances or it's resources, okay? Because he uses storehouse, open the heavens, and he uses the term lending. So now he's talking about something here that a lot of us would like him not to be talking about. So then here sits one of the challenges to prosperity. We tend to get tied up in the blessing and not the blesser. We focus more on it than him. So if you think about it, when you start your prayer in the morning, are you always praying just for yourself? Or do you start with lifting him up and glorifying him? That'll tell you where the difference is, because he needs to be magnified. He needs to be part of our heart. He needs to be the first and foremost of our day, right? And things block that. Because if we do this, if we look at the blessing and not the blesser, we'll be tied up in the curse and we'll curse our own blessing, which is called mammon, right? Let me show you. So you remember Pastor Tracy talking about the lusts of the flesh, the I feel, the I want, and the I will? This one ties right into the I want, which is in that soulish slide of the greed category. Mammon is in the I want. So mammon is this. It's the god of riches, or mammon is actually a spirit, and it's the spirit of selfishness on stuff. Why didn't I say the spirit of selfishness on your stuff? Because you've had it confused all along, and it's not yours. It's his. Mammon is the spirit of Antichrist. Whoa, easy, man. The spirit of Antichrist. What do you mean? Yes, because it becomes the provider rather than God. Right? So we look at our job higher than we've placed God in our life. Or we look at the blessing bigger than we look at God. We pray for the blessing, but we've forgotten about the blesser. Mammon is looking for servants, and I'll prove it in Matthew 6, 24. It says this, no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. You see, mammon is looking for servants. And if you've ever experienced greed, if you've ever experienced it, then you will know that it will literally turn your whole focus from God and it'll steal your worship. If you've ever experienced hate, like deep hate for somebody, it will take your whole thought life captive because hate controls. If you've ever been around or the spirit of fear has been on you, the spirit like anxiety has been on you, right? If you've ever experienced this, it will cripple your whole body. These things that the enemy uses in our soul prior to transformation can cripple your whole being. That's why the enemy wants to do it, because he can't stand the idea that you have an opportunity to change your whole heart to be spirit-led. Your soul, your mind, your will, and your emotions can be taken over by the Spirit of God. So if you focus on the blesser, you will always be satisfied. If you focus on the blessing, you will never be satisfied. Why? Because if you're focused on the blesser, then whatever's happening around you doesn't matter. Because you're not focused on it, you're focused on him, right? So when he's taking you through a process, he can take you through it because you're focused on him. You're just zoned in right on God himself, not the situation around you, right? I remember when I grew up in a family that was in church all the time. So we were tithers and givers and servers, and we did it all. We were at the church a lot. And then I took a turn away from church for quite a while, 8-9 years when I was traveling the world. And what I found out in that whole process is that you can get to worldly success, worldly prosperity, with an empty soul. You can get there because your soul cannot be filled with money. It cannot be filled with success. It can only be filled with the Spirit of God, which brings happiness and joy and peace, right? Matthew 6, 21. Thank you. Matthew 6, 21 says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Treasure, the definition of that, is just where you put your importance. Where are we putting our importance? Your spirit is prosperous, but your soul drives you towards mammon. So who's in control? Your soul or your spirit? 1 Timothy 6:10 says, for the love of money is a root, one of many roots, possibly, of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. So it's not money, because money's neutral. It's not evil. It's the love of it or the heart behind it that can be evil, right? So it's love of anything from your pre-renewed soul. You got that? It's love of anything from your pre-renewed soul that takes your attention that we're talking about here. So Isaac finds a way around his human soulish tendency in Genesis 26, 12. He's in a time of famine. You've probably heard this scripture before. Then it says, then Isaac sowed in that land and reaped in the same year 100-fold. And the Lord blessed him. The man began to prosper and continued prospering until he became very prosperous. What did Isaac do? He went around normal human tendency and did something opposite. The goal is to be led by the Spirit rather than your circumstances. In a time of famine, everyone else at that time was holding tight because they were convinced that it was theirs instead of his. Isaac shows us in that picture what that really looks like. Now, you might be thinking, man, this sounds like the prosperity gospel or something. I don't know if you've ever heard of the prosperity gospel. So it's God wants you blessed all the time, or God wants to make you rich is more the prosperity gospel. Then there's the poverty gospel. God wants you to be poor all the time, right? And we've been trained in this stuff if we've grown up in church one way or the other. What I would call this is more of the provisional gospel. What God wants to do is give you more than you need so that you can be a blessing. So at the end of God's tour for you to get you to prosperity, we are actually more blessed than money can provide, right? So I think we're proven prosperous not by our bank statement, but by our giving statement.
Oh, that's good. Oh, that's
those that might say, well, I don't have enough to give, will never have enough to give. Those that give, if you ask them how they're doing, they will say, I'm blessed. It's just the way it works. It really is. This is how God looks at it. In Genesis 12:2, he says, I will make you a great nation. He's not afraid of making you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great. And you shall be a blessing. So I'm going to do this. What I've called you to do is be a blessing, right? So the catch is he wants you to be a blessing. It's so important that we steward what he shares with us to the rest of the world. Not just our resources, but everything that he shares with us. Everything, patience, peace, joy, goodness, everything that he fills our soul up with from our spirit, we should share with others. So I think every person in this room has something that they can work on. Even this guy on this stage right here has multiple things that we can work on, right? So how do we do that? Real simply, James 4:2 says, yet you do not have because you do not ask. And let me redefine that ask there for a second, because that can be defined as require. A better word for ask might be require. Why? Because we can ask without asking, if through obedience. If our spirit man tells us to do something and we just obey, that's asking without asking. Because you end up in the spot where the blessing hits you. If you listen to your spirit man more than your old soulish man, you will be in the right spot at the right time every single time. Because God's got prosperity, he's got blessing, he's got favor in mind for you. So it actually, that ask actually requires God's involvement in your situation. So nobody in this room is all good. I want you to look at this slide one last time. And I want you to see this side. And I want you to focus on maybe the one that you need to work on. Maybe that one piece that God's been speaking to you throughout this series. That's you, that you need to work on. And I want you to all bow your heads just for a moment. Now, with every eye closed, I want you to do this. I want you to think of the exact opposite of that word that you were just focusing on. Because the exact opposite is what God wants to do in your life. So now I'm just going to declare over you a couple of the I am statements, but I'm going to make them you are statements. You are love. You are joy. You are peace. You are generous. You are patient. You are gentle. You are self-controlled. You are bold. You are all that God says you are. You are free. God, I just thank you for this moment in time today. God, I just hope that you spoke to every single person in this room individually for them today, God. I thank you that today that they're going to walk out of here even different than ever before with one step in front of them that they can change and accept your Spirit's answer in, God. I thank you for filling their soul with good things. I thank you for filling their hearts with all that you have in store for them. Now just keep your heads bowed just for one more moment this morning, because we don't ever want to leave without the opportunity to meet Jesus for the very first time. If you're in this place and you would love to get to that spot that we were talking about of prosperity, where your heart is just full, it starts with one man and his name is Jesus. And I want to give you the opportunity today to take a step of faith. Your step of faith is not going to be awkward or anything. We're all going to say a prayer together, but your step of faith is just to raise your hand and say, God, that's me. So if that's you this morning and he's working on your heart, or you're sweating a little bit, you're like, man, I know he's talking to me. Nobody's looking around. So this is between you and God. I'm going to give just another second. Just raise your hand in this place if that's you. And between you and Jesus, he is going to fill your spirit this morning. Just repeat this after me. Father God, I believe that Jesus is my Lord and Savior. Jesus, take over my heart. Fill me up. I believe that you died on the cross and rose from the dead for my sins. In Jesus' name, amen. That's an exciting moment. I think you should celebrate that for a moment. So if that's you in here and you just met Jesus for the very first time, there are steps that are necessary for your process, okay? You might have kind of gotten that out of the message today, but what we have in that worship guide also is a connection card that your next step, we can help you with it if you just check the box that says, I just received Jesus for the very first time or something like that. You'll find the box. If you can check that and hand it into the offering bins as they go past, then we can help you with your next step in your walk with Jesus. Amen.